get started. Thank you everyone coming out tonight.
I know we had our speaker canceled, but luckily we had someone step in last minute, so thank you very much.
Tonight we have Dom Code and Jeremy Gilreath. They're going to be chatting about analytics and prediction-based stuff, which I find very interesting. So let's give them a nice warm round of applause.
Hey there.
Thank you.
So this is, there's more to predicting the price of Bitcoin than you think. And the reason I named it that is that we gave this talk, part of this talk, at Cryptolina in 2018 in June. And we've taken that talk and we've done a lot of work since then. So we have a lot of the content from the original talk and we're going to add to it with the stuff that we've discovered since then. So, I'm Don Code. I'm one of three co-founders of Unspecified LLC. We're a local startup over in Durham. I'll talk about what we do in just a minute or so. I've been in the blockchain space for about 6 years. I've been in software for about 18 years. I have a degree in computer science from Clemson, which is a bizarre computer science school because they're an ag school, really. But they had a pretty good computer science curriculum. I like to contribute to open source. I love all things fringy and techie, and I enjoy keeping up with new technologies. You want to talk about yourself, Jeremy?
Yeah, I'm Jeremy. Don's my boss. I'm a full-stack developer at Unspecified, and two of the things that I'm most passionate about are clean code and machine learning. Those are they dovetail together really nicely, and tonight we're going to be talking about something really cool that we have been working on since February, right?
Yeah.
So there you go, Don.
That was a cool sound. Was that you, Eric? So we are not professional traders. I just want to say that. We don't play professional traders on TV. So as we talk about some trading techniques that are used in financial markets, I just want to be clear that we may misstep. We may talk about things naively. That's just going to happen. So who's Unspecified? Unspecified is a little startup firm. Our motto is we intend to disrupt the status quo for software delivery. We're not a dev shop. We do Go. Platform architecture. We believe in clean code. We believe in well-architected code. We believe in modern software practices. Sometimes we use that word agile, but I don't think I need to use it anymore. We do DevOps consulting. We do have a pretty significant DevOps team, people who have a lot of experience in IT, networking, DevOps, delivery, etc. We do blockchain development, blockchain delivery. Our target customer is somebody who has a POC or an early blockchain product that they want to be full-time, ready for enterprise-level customer production type release. We do machine learning. This is actually the reason that we started the company. I had a lot of interest in machine learning. I have a software testing background. I believed that machine learning could really aid and accelerate software testing and software delivery in general. We are working at some point on a product toward that end as well. We also do quality consulting. Several members of our team have a background in software testing and overall software quality and software delivery. All right, so let's talk Bitcoin. This is the price chart for Bitcoin from about the beginning, I believe that's January of 2009, to July of 2018.
Yep.
Aha! We see our very familiar little spike in there. Clearly predicting what the price of Bitcoin is going to do is kind of tricky, right? Most people have seen and have experience with that. So here's Bitcoin right now. This is the past 6 months or so. And again, as you can see, it's pretty volatile. Everybody's familiar with that. So when it comes to trying to predict financial markets, cryptocurrencies may or may not follow some of the same techniques that we see in some of the other financial markets. We know of technical analysis techniques that are used. People use things like looking for trend lines, like taking this line up here all the way up to this peak up here and seeing where that's going to take us. People use candlestick information to find out where they think things are going to go next. There's a lot of information in old school financial market trading analysis. Does it apply to cryptocurrencies? It's actually a pretty good question. The problem problem is, just looking at what's going on in a financial market actually doesn't give us a ton of information about what we think might happen next in a given financial market. We can try to follow patterns, we can try to look at trends that we've seen over time in all of the financial markets, but it's actually kind of difficult to use that to predict what's going to happen next. Why is that? Go. Nope, I missed a slide. Nope, wrong way. Back, back, and back. That was forward. It's gonna go, I'm telling you. Back. It's not. So anyway, there was a slide that's being skipped that says the difference is the human factor. There are human beings involved, and the financial markets don't really tell you about human behavior and why human beings do the things that they do. Human beings do things as a matter of community and what they say to each other and how they feel about things, and the financial markets don't really capture that information. So what we set off to do was we set off to collect a whole bunch of data that would help us, when applied with a machine learning algorithm, to figure out if we could predict what's going to happen next in the Bitcoin charts and its finances. So, as a start, we collected news headlines from all of these sources of news. They're kind of scattered across the world. And we looked at information about what was going on in the headlines as far as cryptocurrencies went, blockchain stuff, Bitcoin stuff, those kinds of things. And then we did sentiment analysis on those headlines. We tried to figure out if we thought they would have a positive, a neutral, or a negative impact, other way around, on the price of Bitcoin. We also collected a whole bunch of other data. So data like what natural disasters were happening across the globe and what statistics can we pull out of the natural disasters. Conflict data, wars, number of fatalities, what's going on behind the conflict, political data, elections, and stuff like that. Obviously financial data, so we're looking at traditional stock markets, other financial markets across the globe, and bringing all that information together, as well as some cryptocurrency data and what's going on with the cryptocurrencies across the globe. And then some like Google Trend analysis, finding out where some of these topics are going in Google Trends. We brought all that data together. Why? Ah, this is the slide I thought I was missing. Aha, humans. Sorry I gave that part. That's why it wouldn't go to that slide. So, just to be sure everybody's on the same page about what machine learning is, there's a lot of hype around machine learning. I want to be sure that we level set and make sure that we all are on the same page about what machine learning actually is. And now I'm going to pass that over to Jeremy, because he's my data science guy, and he's going to explain machine learning.
Cool, thank you. Stuck.
Here you go.
All right. All right, so machine learning is basically one of several subsets of artificial intelligence, and it itself is broken up into multiple subsets that we'll get to later. But essentially, what machine learning is a way to let a program make decisions or predict values or perform some action without being explicitly programmed on how to perform that action. So behind the scenes, it's all statistics. It's stuff that you'll find in collegiate textbooks. It's nothing secret. It's just dense, and it takes time and it takes patience to wrap your head around it and practice it. But that's true of most other things. So none of you should feel like any of this is, you know, necessarily something that you can't begin diving into on your own. So a lot of times it seems like it's magic, but it's not. Now, as far as machine learning in particular goes, there are machine learning and artificial intelligence, they've been evolving steadily, especially in the last few years. The different kinds of subsets they are, what they include, what they don't, how people talk about it keeps shifting. But for machine learning in particular, there are three main categories of it. Supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. And I'm going to go to a graphic now to show you what that looks like. Our project in particular is a type of supervised learning called supervised regression learning. And I'll explain what that means. So I don't know how well you can read the small print on this graphic, but this sort of shows how these types of machine learning branch out from one another and are categorized. So on the upper left here, and on supervised learning, you've got things like clustering, which is where recommender systems fall into. This is your Spotify that will recommend your new daily playlist or your weekly playlist to you. It's how Netflix knows that after you've watched Shrek 1, 2, and 3, you probably want Shrek 4 if it exists, or, you know, just maybe have a Shrek problem. It's, you know, targeted marketing. I might have a Shrek problem. So targeted marketing. This is how Facebook, you know, gets these ad campaigns to bid for your click on a page and serves up ads specific to you. That's another example of unsupervised learning. Down here on the bottom is reinforcement learning. That's stuff like the really cool and creepy robots that Boston Dynamics comes up with, and it's also programs like AlphaGo, where they use game artificial intelligence to teach it how to play a game and ultimately figure out how to play it better yet differently than a person might. And in the upper right is where our project falls into. This is supervised learning. And in supervised learning, there is classification problems, which is basically figuring out, is this thing a dog or is it a pineapple? You know, is this a piece of candy or is it a photo of John Candy? That's classification in a nutshell, yes or no. But regression, that's different. That's predicting like a discrete value on some sort of range for a thing that you're interested in our case, the close price of Bitcoin. So this is where our project fell into. So how does this all work, right? There's a lengthy process that we have to go through. The first step is to figure out what data you want. Where is it on the web? And you've got to scrape it all, automate the gathering and the collection of it into one central location for you to proceed to the next step in the process. That's a considerable amount of work because each data source is going to be on a different website, managed and programmed and organized by different people with different levels of skills and ideas. There's no one size fits all solution to this. Each different data source requires its own approach and solution. It's tough to be flexible yet automated in this area. After you get the data, you've got to clean it. You've got to scrub it because this stuff is put out there by all kinds of different people. A lot of it's manual and tedious, which means that it's easy to make a mistake. It's even easier to not to notice when you make a mistake. I have found a lot of, like, in one of our academic sources for disaster data, I found 7 different misspellings of an African nation. And because it was in a database with like 30,000 different records and just one person occasionally would, you know, type something incorrectly. So that's the sort of thing that you contend with when you gather information from the web, as I'm sure you all know. You can't just trust it all. So you have to analyze it very carefully and figure out how to flexibly yet reliably get that into a state that you're able to do further work with. And that next step after that comes in the form of engineering features. This means taking data, like say from the Weather Channel, maybe we're interested in weather data and we've got, you know, was it sunny? Was it raining? What day of the week was it? And maybe from the day of the week column, we actually were able to tell, well, is it a weekend day or is it a weekday day? And from that, and also from the dates, you're able to say like, well, was this in March? Was this in April? Was this in summer? Was this in winter? This is taking the data that you start out with and engineering new features out of that data with new values. This is very important because one type of data can be very dense, can have a lot of different discrete meanings, and some of those might matter a lot more than the rest. So you want to end up sort of separating all that and only selecting the wheat and throw away the chaff. It's a pretty important part of this pipeline. So after that comes the actual part of building and training the machine learning models. So different models have a lot of different algorithms you can choose depending on what sort of data you're working with, whether you have a whole lot of features or columns in your data, whether you have a whole lot of rows in your data, whether most of the data has zeros for values, which would make it sparse, whether most of the data doesn't, and that makes it dense. They all have little peculiarities, things that they're better or worse suited to than one another. And they also have parameters you have to tune that they can't automatically figure out how to tune themselves. So these hyperparameters have to be tuned Well, they should be tuned before you use them, because it figures out how to appropriately find the value that you're looking for and not something else that is misleading. So before you end up selecting which of all these features we've gathered, of which there were about 900, which of those are most important for any given algorithm, you actually have to tune the algorithm to do its job best. And you have to repeat that process after feature selection and before you actually train the model using that algorithm on the features that you did select. So what this looks like is you decide which algorithm you want to use, you tweak some numbers, it tells you which of these 900 or so features that we have gathered for predicting the price of Bitcoin end up mattering to that algorithm, and then you say, okay, well, let's save those all in a file, and you tweak these numbers again, and you say, okay, algorithm, now, rather than selecting features, I want you to actually take these that was selected by yourself or some other algorithm, and then learn to actually do the prediction work. So we had like 11, 10 different algorithms. Some could be used for selecting the features. Some were better suited for not, some of them couldn't actually be used for regression because some of the algorithms used to select features aren't regression algorithms. So they were better suited for classifying. They're like I don't know if anyone's ever heard of things like extra trees or random forests. Those are classification mechanisms. They can't be used ultimately to train the model. So there were 96 to 100 different combinations of algorithms used to select features and train models. So we used them all and we let them sort of duke it out and tell us which one ended up being the best in the end by evaluating all the models. So that brings us to one of the last steps, is actually how do we evaluate these models? Well, there are scores, statistical measures of how well it did in predicting the close price of Bitcoin that it will end up reporting to you in the end. And you can tell how far off, on average, by an order of magnitude, that it was from being able to accurately predict. So the one with the lowest rate of error is actually the best one. So after you have trained all these different combinations of algorithms to get your model that is based on your features, and you know which one's the best, you want to plot the results so that you can actually see it in a chart, and because this is a really powerful and simple way to communicate information. So we have it spit out charts for every 96 model along with the statistics, and we can see how well they perform. And at the top of the chart, you're going to see a measurement called RMSE, which I'll talk in a moment. But first, it's worth mentioning one more thing about machine learning models, and that is overfitting. And I guess it's corollary, underfitting. So fitting describes how well the balance between training on a subset of data and accurately predicting new values for data it has not seen is achieved by the model. If a model has overfit, that is exemplified by the green line in this image. And what that means is that the training data was used appropriately, but the algorithm itself did a poor job at striking the balance between picking up the signal and the data that's useful for predicting, but also doing a good job of being able to generalize to new information in the future it has not seen yet to make a prediction that holds up. So this is an image that is showing overfitting in a classification machine learning model. Red versus blue. Is it red or is it blue? The line, as you can see, very tightly follows that boundary between red and blue. But this is undesirable, because when you actually go to use this model in the real world, it's not going to do well. It's only doing well in the data you already had that you already knew the answers for. That's not why you're building it to begin with, so you don't want that. What you want is that balance, that middle ground, and that is illustrated by the black line. An example of underfitting is I mean, that's just as bad. That means it's also really awful at predicting, but it would sort of like be just like from the lower left to the upper right or something. Yeah, it just wouldn't make any sense.
Underfitting might run like from here to here.
Yeah. There would be little rhyme or reason to it. You also wouldn't want to use that. So the middle ground is what you want to strike for. And the way that you evaluate how under or over fit your model is are also statistical measures that you get. And there are well-known methods for avoiding overfitting. The one that we use is something called K-fold cross-validation. It sounds fancy, but it's really not. What it means is that you take all this data that looks like a spreadsheet. You've got columns and rows, right? You split the spreadsheet into a number of folds equal to K. So say it's 5. So what happens is you set one of these aside, you train the model on these 4 over here, and you use that one you set aside to evaluate it. And you repeat this process for each one of those folds, and then you cross-reference those results, and that tells you how close you are to striking this balance or how far away you are. So that's how you avoid it. It's pretty standard. It's built into these third-party, you know, scientific data science libraries that you'll find in languages like Python. So you don't have to try to home roll your own solution to that kind of stuff. So this is a chart of the results from the predictions that we had generated from our model. So we trained it on everything up to like February of 2018, from August 16th, 2010. And then from February up until about June, there was 100 days of data that the model had never before seen that we gave it in order to test it to see how well it could predict the close price of Bitcoin. And that's what you're seeing here. So the first thing to notice is the distribution of the orange dots, which are the discrete predictions. On the left, on the vertical axis, is the actual close price of Bitcoin on that day. And on the x-axis on the bottom is what it predicted. A perfect model would just be a straight line orange from bottom left to upper right, 100% accurate, no errors. So this shows us that, you know, it's doing pretty well, right? But how well? We see at the top there is a measure that it says 401.63 for RMSE. RMSE stands for root mean squared error. What that is a very commonly used statistical measure to describe the magnitude of error in predictions for a model. This means that generally a prediction was off by $400 from the maximum value that Bitcoin ever had. Sometimes less, sometimes a little more. But this is the general magnitude of the error in this. And so you're able to see that during this time, you know, I'm not able to go back to the first slide, but the data that we trained on, that was the very turbulent period of Bitcoin's history. The model had never seen any of that. It had only seen a slight rise in like the 3 or 4 months at the very tail end of the data that it was training on. So this has values ranging from like 19,000 something all the way down to like 7,000 something. So, but how accurate does that mean it was, right? So it was 98.25% accurate, because this residual amount, this RMSE, which is $401.63 that the average error was off by, is just 1.75% of the max that it was during this training period. That's very high accuracy. And when we take the same model and we try to predict all the values of Bitcoin from the beginning, from, you know, August 16th, 2010, it sort of provides us a zoomed out view so we can get a better visual appreciation for just how accurate the model is. Now, this is showing 99.58% accuracy, which is like 1% greater than the last, but it looks much tighter because there's many more observations. It's a different scale. The reason the accuracy went up when we predicted the values all the way back to the beginning was because most of that data the model trained on. It knew what to expect. It's an artificially inflated accuracy measure when you do something like that. So that's why the RMSE went way down and the percentage only went up by a little bit. So, this is me? Yeah. All right, so what did we learn along the way? We learned a lot of things. One, that is a probably can't be understated is that doing a project like this, building a machine learning application that has a useful real world, you know, value, it's very tough. It takes a lot of time, a lot of work. Things can go wrong. A lot of unexpected turns can occur. And you know, we also learned that there's things that we can do to improve the model, like get more data, for instance. This chart was only up until like June of this year. So we can get the interceding months of data there and see how that improves things. We can also get new types of data that we didn't have before and extract new features that we did not have on the old data that might be more useful to our ability to predict than some of the old features were. And we could also, maybe if we wanted to, choose a totally different target variable. You know, if we're talking about using this to trade, maybe the close price of Bitcoin is itself not directly what we want to target. Maybe we want to find the peaks and valleys and the trends themselves to know when we want to buy down here at the bottom and when we want to sell at the top. And now, Dawn rushes to her computer to unlock it. This is the fun part, audience participation. Are y'all ready to play a game? Yes, you have a question? Go ahead.
I was going to pause for questions.
Yeah.
So can you talk a little bit about the element of time? In other words,
absolutely.
Capturing Bitcoin prices at a point in time, to capturing data influencing Bitcoin price that not necessarily correlated in time, or are they? That type of stuff.
So the question was about time and how it factors into the data that we collect and what data we use and on what time scale the data is.
What about us consider time and its association? You know, because you would think about data as cause and effect, right? So
gotcha.
Cause and effect at a certain time, or that's it. So that's how I think.
Yes. So cause and effect at a certain time. Like does some of our data rely on observations that happened previously in time to inform itself?
Or even how you normalize time across the various data sets, if that's even important.
So normalizing time across data sets isn't something that we actually do. And in fact, when we gather data to use in this machine learning project, it's on the order of day increments. And the individual discrete rows in our data, in our spreadsheets that hold all the data, they correspond to individual days. And the date column itself is not actually used in the machine learning portion at all. It's just for our benefit as the people that are engineering this thing and looking at it. It doesn't actually factor in, except that this data is something called time series data, right? There's a definite time order to all of these observations. The data for, you know, January 15th definitely happened before the data for January 16th. And that factors into some of the approaches for machine learning that we could take. For instance, one of the ways to sort of avoid overfitting is shuffling all your data up and seeing if it performs the same way across shuffles, how well they perform, and you can like cross-validate them. But you can't do that with time series data because there's a meaningful order. It would totally screw up the machine learning algorithm's ability to learn anything at all. It would totally destroy the plot of, you know, for instance, the actual price of Bitcoin. It would look different every time you shuffle the data. So you have to actually maintain that order. And what that means is that when we trained our models, we had to take a chunk at the very beginning, from August 16th, 2010, all the way down to 100 days before our cutoff date. That's what we used to train. And the data that we used to test had to come after that. So in that way, not only did we maintain a definite order to our data and respect its time series nature, but we're still able to use data down here that the machine learning algorithms have never seen before in order to test it and its ability to generalize that it had acquired through the learning process.
So
Yeah. You basically take the data for a given day and predict the Bitcoin price for the end of that day.
Yes, that's what we were doing. We were taking data from that day and predicting the close Bitcoin price for that same day. And it's also worth mentioning that in this project, at this point in the project, we had never directly used the previous day's data in any way, whether it was the Bitcoin close price or any of the other features that we had. Each day was its own self-contained prediction. We did not use, you know, the last 3 days or the last 7 days of all these different features that we had. That would have given it probably a big leg up in accuracy, but we were interested in predicting the price of Bitcoin without using the price of Bitcoin itself to predict itself.
Okay.
Any other questions? Yeah.
All right. So at this point, have you all tried to build a trading system around this, or just purely figure out the data?
Ooh, do you want
to? I think we're gonna hold on.
Just a little longer. Yeah. Thanks for asking that, though. We were definitely going to talk about how it factors into actual trading strategies. Yes.
So when you guys decided to switch data from your graph and your screen, what was the process for identifying what things you thought could be important?
Sorry, could you say that one more time?
Yeah. So like when you guys originally went to go collect data, right? You said you had like 900 different data points.
Yes.
The question I had is, how did you determine what was worth trying? So I think you said
a pretty great question. How we went about even deciding what data to gather, what rhyme or reason was there to choosing, you know, news headlines and disaster data and trend analysis. It sort of leveraged a bit of my background in sociology. See, that was actually my first love, my first academic pursuit. I got my first degree in sociology before I got my second in computer science and business. And I know from those 8 years of undergrad and grad school that there are a lot of things that drive human behavior that have not changed a whole lot over the course of human history. One of those things is news. So, you know, receiving information tends to drive people to either seek out even more information or act upon that information, right? So learning things about the market or the things that influences it are clearly going to drive people to potentially buy or sell. So that's how I knew that news headlines and the information that they contain would be relevant to this project. Trend analysis on Google search results was interesting because that's an example of that first case I mentioned where people get information and then they go looking for other information. And that tends to happen around interesting times. You know, whether something is doing really well or really poorly or it's being talked about in the news, those are all, you know, those are all really strong reasons for people to engage in market activity. And it tends to be centered around when it's doing poorly or it's doing really well. It's a really strong predictor, Google Analytics was. As far as, you know, disasters for thousands of years have been strong drivers of economic activity. You know, people move, estates change, people buy things, people repair their cities, their towns, taxes change. There can even be, you know, new elections. Disasters have the power to change entire cultures. So, you know, they're going to have the power to induce people to buy and sell a commodity. Now, what were some of the others?
Political data.
Political data, yes. Elections. Elections tend to come with certain things attached to them, like certain kinds of people in the government. Are they conservative? Are they not? What sorts of policies come along with them? We know these things have an impact on the economy. They always do. And people in the government tend to be largely responsible for, you know, things like taxation, economic policy, foreign policy, These things are also drivers of economic activity, all the way down to individuals like us. So when it comes to democratic first world countries like ours, or non-democratic third world countries, like we have, there are many of those on Earth, these all matter because cryptocurrencies are everywhere. They're global. They play very varied roles depending on the country and the culture and the community that they're in. Some for people here, we don't really rely on them generally for our whole living. We don't support ourselves fully on cryptocurrency generally. But in many third world countries, that's precisely what they do, for instance. So when there is, to speak of a different data set, conflict, military conflict, non-military conflict, and there are, you know, deaths, protests, cultural change associated with those things, we have people doing things like moving their money out of one area that is unstable and moving it into another area that is stable, or at least a different commodity. That's happened for thousands of years too. So using all of these insights I have from my, you know, really dorky love of history and my powerful, expensive insight into people and what they do and why they do it that came with my sociology degree, I went about picking the data that we gathered using those sets of assumptions. And I didn't really need to stray very far from those. They ended up being really valuable for us.
So before we go on, I think Daniel had a question too.
Oh yes, please.
Just to talk about the RMSE number.
Yes.
So the way I understand that is if yesterday's price was 10,000 and your RMSE of 401, that's saying that the price tomorrow is going to be plus or minus 400 from 10,000 or plus or minus 200?
It means it could be plus or minus 400.
Yeah.
On average, yeah, yeah.
So tomorrow's price.
The question is it a directional measure or just a magnitude?
It's a magnitude measure, but it ends up meaning that, you know, it can go in either direction. It doesn't actually just mean it can only be 400 above. It means it can be 400 above or below. Yeah. Great question.
Any other questions? Go ahead.
Did you train your data for time frames or just across the entire time frame?
So the time frame that we used to train our data, train the model using our data, began at August 16th, 2010, and it was trained up until sometime in February, and then from February to like June was the data that we used to test that trained model. Any other questions before y'all play a game?
Go ahead.
Shoot.
What did John do to break your leg?
You know?
Sweet tea vodka.
Sweet tea vodka.
I'm going to tell that story forever, even though it's not even true.
Tell it. It's a good story.
I'm just kidding. I'm not really going to tell it. Because there was no sweet tea vodka involved in your ankle. All right, let's go. Oh, stay on. I need a stronger clip on this thing. Go.
All right, so let's play a game. Just so you guys know, too, we're controlling the slides on our phones,
yeah.
In case you're wondering why we keep looking at our phones. All right, so the titles of these slides is going to say, is this a good predictor? And technically, these things aren't things that were necessarily predictors of the price of Bitcoin. They were just extremely highly or not highly correlated with the price of Bitcoin. So I want you to put your hands up if you think that the Dow Jones high, low, open, and close are highly correlated with the price of Bitcoin. Oh, yeah, nobody.
Yeah. No.
Nope. Yeah. Yeah, no, not at all. There's
really
almost,
dead.
Yeah, no relationship.
Yeah. Like these things are measured on a scale from 0.0 to 1.0. That was less than 0.05.
How about total number of wars in the on the subnational scale in Eastern Africa? What do you think? I got two people, three, four, five, six or so who say yeah. Yeah? It's pretty highly correlated. Do you remember the number on this one?
It was over 0.95.
All right.
No, it means that you can use that value to infer a directional relationship between it and the price of Bitcoin, whether positive or negative.
Good question. I like that one. All right, how about Total posts per day on Reddit about Bitcoin.
I bet you're all on Reddit.
There were a lot of yeses, and then all those hands went down. All right, Nope.
Awful.
Strange, right? You'd think if people are talking about it, there must be some activity going on behind it.
So that 0 day lag, this question might change a lot if you're looking at a 5 day lag offset.
So there's a lot of good information behind that question.
Yeah.
So yes and no. Yes and no, and yes and no. Okay. And, and depending on which algorithm you're talking about. Because remember, we are running something like 97 different combinations of algorithms and parameters. Yep.
So if there's a bunch of posts on Reddit, you're just saying don't predict if it's higher or lower because
it's a strong trend. We're saying that there's not a direct correlation between what's going on here and what's going on in the price of Bitcoin. So sometimes there are really high number of posts on Reddit and Bitcoin does nothing. Sometimes high number of posts on Reddit and Bitcoin's going nuts. They weren't correlated with each other.
Just nope. Number of posts overall. What that mention?
I'm gonna try to move this again. Stay. Okay. All right. Daily high and close performance of the Karachi 100. This is Pakistan's primary stock exchange. Yes? No? Actually, raise your hand if you think this is a yes. Go for it, Stacy. Yeah. Good job. I will give you a gold star. How about daily Bitcoin miner revenue? What's the significance of miner revenue, you think? I mean, I would think, right, if I'm earning more via mining, then there must be some good stuff going on, right? Wait, what? It says yes and no? How can it be yes and no? I actually already alluded to it. And it is about the fact that we're running this entire combination of algorithms, and sometimes it was highly correlated, and sometimes it wasn't, depending on the algorithms that we ran and the parameters that we ran in it. So my example to kind of give everybody in, hey, there's one right there. Give you an illustration that explains this is kids, right? This is my daughter, this is Riley. She's now 6. She looks super sweet in that picture, doesn't she? Super sweet, right? This is also Riley. Not so sweet here. Both best and the worst, same person. All right, so this is a list, and I'm not going to read it out loud to you, but this is a list, you can find it on our slides, you can read some of it now, of a lot of features that we found that were often highly correlated with the price of Bitcoin. There are some really interesting things in there. I see in there, for example, there's a couple of good funny ones in here, like successful military coups in Africa for the month. What?
What's the square root of that number?
Well, so the RMSE, right? There was another one. Oh, yeah. Total world leaders that came into power this month through a military path. How often does that happen, first of all? Second of all, who would know, right? Like, just thinking about and really discovering, I think one of the best parts of doing this project was discovering all of these things that go on across the world that we had no idea would be correlated with financial markets at all. Total number of wars on the subnational scale in Eastern Africa, I think I actually went over that one. Daily, I went over that one too. Opening of the IBEX 35, which is in Spain. Okay, I guess they're doing some cool shit in Spain too. All right, so here are a list of features that were often not correlated very well with the price of Bitcoin. There's our Dow Jones, there's our total posts per day on Reddit, and daily average overall sentiment of international news headlines.
There's also a whole lot of Bitcoin-specific financial metrics that were just completely irrelevant. So we're going to bring on that slide.
Sorry, we didn't put them on there. Okay, so the ugly is that mix of things where sometimes in some algorithms and some mixes of parameters, they appeared to be highly correlated, but in other ones, they did not. Again, look at this one. Attempted military coups in the Americas this month. Okay, Actually, I heard a really interesting story. We were talking to somebody at Cryptolina after we gave this talk at Cryptolina, and he said, I can totally understand how some of this information about natural disasters or wars can have an impact on something like the price of cryptocurrency. And what he brought up to me was Puerto Rico. Yeah. Puerto Rico being all but destroyed a few years ago. Well, Puerto Rico for the Americas has been a safe haven for cryptocurrencies. So when Puerto Rico got damaged heavily, it was a hurricane, I believe, people poured their cryptocurrency in to help bring it back to life. That's where there was a lot of cryptocurrency activity happening for the Americas. So we have in here, this is one of my favorite ones too. Code repos, open and closed poll issues on code repos concerning Bitcoin. All right, cool. Sometimes that was a good indicator and sometimes it wasn't. All right, so here's the $1 million question, and I think I hear this question all the time now. Do we use this to invest our own Bitcoin? No. No, not yet, at least. No, and I'll tell you why. Right, so why not? So at the time we presented this at Cryptolina, the model was only predicting current day close price, which wasn't really giving us much of what we needed to be able to say make money off of trading on it. What we wanted to do was have it predict the future, right? That makes sense. So after we left Cryptolina, that was the first thing we set off to do. We set off to have this model train on predicting tomorrow's Bitcoin close price. We thought we could make some money off of that. We were wrong. So at first, we were really excited. We were like, yes, we've got it going. It's doing super awesome. Its accuracy rate is 99.8%. That's amazing. I love it. Now that we have that number, what do we do? Cool. So what we had to do, obviously, was ask ourselves a few questions. And the first one obviously looks like, if we were to invest money into Bitcoin using those predictions, would we actually make money? It's a good question, right? Actually, it's multiple questions. So first, how can we prove that using this predicted price would actually make money for an investor? Second, if the predictions were as accurate as it looked, would they definitely outperform other trading models? As we've already referred to, there are a lot of models for doing trading in financial markets that have existed before and in the crypto markets. And then second, this is kind of important to us, is once a day enough? Should we try to bring it down to 10-minute increments or 1-hour increments and try to do something more like day trading? Maybe that would give us some information that we might be able to make some money off of. Most of the day traders are doing it at that kind of granularity. They're not just trading once a day. All right, so one of the first things we did was we picked a very simple trading model to compare the results to our model's predictions. We're going to call this one the trend model. So the trend model predicts that the market will perform in the next 24 hours the way it did in the last 24 hours. So what that means is, if between yesterday and today the price of Bitcoin went down by $20, I'm going to predict that by tomorrow it goes down by $20. That's it. That's all this model does. We can also call it the past performance does indicate future performance model, because anybody who's done trading knows the phrase that past performance, right, la la la. Actually, I only know that phrase because of software. I don't know it because of trading. So we set to Excel. Why not, right? This is where you can crunch some numbers. Most of us are familiar with it. I don't expect you to read any of those numbers. This is one of the early spreadsheets that we put together to compare what this trend model would do versus what the machine learning algorithm did. One thing that it does highlight is this green line right here is one date, this is May 9th, on which the machine learning model predicted an inflection point in the price of Bitcoin a day before the trend model did. So the machine learning model said, oop, the price of Bitcoin is going to go from going up to going down, or the other direction, I can't remember. And it took it another day for the trend model to see that that was actually happening. Eek. Okay, so this chart represents 100 days. This is April 10th through July 18th or something like that. And I purposely did it at this scale so that you could just tell. There are three lines on here. One is the trend model prediction, one is the machine learning model prediction, and one is the actual price. They're all pretty damn close to each other. But if we zoom in a little bit, we start to see some interesting things. The gray line is our actual. The red line is our trend model. The blue line is the machine learning model. You guys are all smart crypto and blockchain people. What does that mean? Tell me, what would you think if you came across that? Yeah?
Very trend heavy, machine learning.
So the machine learning model seems to be trend heavy is what you said, right? Yeah, so there definitely seemed to be a correlation between the two, right? And we were kind of like, that's weird. We did notice that there was a high correlation between the two. Any other observations or like what would you say that means? We had all this data that we put into the machine learning model. How could something as simple as this trend model possibly perform right along with it? How does that make sense? And the truth is, I don't know the answer yet. What I do know is I have lots of questions now. We have a lot of questions to answer now. All it did was give us a whole bunch more questions. But we do know actually a few more things. When we really got to looking at how the trend model was performing relative to the machine learning model was a little bit more accurate. If you look at the difference between the machine learning model and the trend model and the actual line, the machine learning model was performing a little bit better. And it did, in a couple of cases, predict an inflection point a day earlier than the trend model did, which, depending on what you're doing with your money, could be really important. Also, when used to inform on a day-to-day trading strategy, for the most part, they resulted in the same buy and sell decisions. Technically, in that 100-day set, the machine learning model predicted that one inflection point one day earlier than the trend model once, which technically resulted in a $39 difference with a one Bitcoin as the starting investment. There are some nuances to how that trading happened, right? So obviously we're working on better ways to leverage the predictive accuracy that we did find for trading. And how do we do that? We want to know, will Bitcoin hit $50,000 by the end of the year? That's been the question all year, right? Yeah. All right, I think that by this point, we're pretty sure it's not going to. But what we can do is, we can see if we can use the predictive model in some other ways. It may help us if we can get something like a confidence metric from it. So maybe the predictive model can say, we predict the price of Bitcoin is going to be this tomorrow with 99% confidence, or with 80% confidence, in which case we know that it's not as confident in what's going to happen the next day as it, obviously, if it had a higher confidence interval. Aha! So stay tuned. You got to keep following Unspecified to see what we do with it from here. This is literally the point that we're at in this project. We've just spent the last week doing a ton of analysis on it, asking ourselves a whole bunch of questions, and figuring out where we're going to go with it from here. On the other hand, what lessons did we learn? So I did not write this because I'm a native English speaker, but this basically says, right, you can kind of do all kinds of stuff with statistics. You know, woo, we have a 99.8% accuracy. But what does that really mean? What can we do with that? In this case, this guy says 100% of people who drink water die, of course, right? I can say drinking water leads to death. But, right? Come on.
It's already started.
It's already started. That was sweet tea vodka, brother. We learned a little bit of humility, right? So we had taken a lot of time to develop this machine learning model and algorithm, gathered a lot of data, took a lot of time to do that, thought we had some amazing statistics on it, and then we found out that actually it didn't make us millionaires, which kind of sucks.
Yeah.
I'd prefer to be a millionaire. What else did we learn? Ah, you may have to fight about it more than once to win it, right? That's the other piece of this is, so we found out some stuff that seems confusing and interesting to us. Keep on going. What else do we have here? One of the only ways to get out of a tight box is to invent your way out. I love this quote because I think it's a good motivator. So we now have to see how creative we can get with what we're going to do from this point forward. And finally, Silicon Valley. I like Silicon Valley. It's one of my favorite TV shows. We quote it all the time. Anyway, so pivot. So maybe we're going to change the direction of where we're taking the machine learning algorithm. Whereas we were, for example, having it predict the price of Bitcoin for tomorrow, one of the things we're considering is have it predict buy and sell points instead of the price of Bitcoin tomorrow. So for example, a lot of times if you look at the financial charts, the price will go up, and it'll start to taper off before you hit your inflection point and it comes down. Maybe we train it instead to figure out when we're hitting an inflection point and let us know about that. So that's one of the directions that we're going to go next. We're having a lot of fun with it for sure. That's all we've got. So we are unspecified. This is our website. We're in downtown Durham at the American Underground, which we really enjoy. Also, thank you, Frontier. And I'm Dawn, and this is Jeremy.
Thank you.